On behalf of the family, we just want to thank each and every one of you for being here this morning. I know it means a lot to them, and it's just a great way to show your love and support. This time we're going to open the service with a song, Amazing Grace.
All right, let's all stand.
Again, thank you so much for being here this morning. I know it means so much to the family. We'll have an opening word of prayer here in just a moment. But, you know, we talked about amazing grace. We just sang about that. And God's grace is amazing. And I'm grateful this morning that we know that Norman received the grace of God. That's when God gives us what we don't deserve. And according to his testimony, we know that he's heaven bound. He's in the presence of the Lord today. The Bible says, Jesus said in John chapter number 11, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And what a great promise that if we know Jesus Christ as Savior, we go to be with him. And Norman's not in heaven this morning based on what he did, but it's based on who he knew. And I hope and pray that you know Christ as Savior. If you do, you have the hope that you're going to see Norman again one day and also go to be with the Lord. We're going to have a quick word of prayer this morning. We'll open the service and then we'll continue on. Father, thank you so much for the privilege of being here, being able to be a part of this homegoing service. And I'm grateful for the life of Norman, what he meant to so many, God, as a father and a grandfather, Lord, a brother, Lord, a son, Lord, all the things that he all the roles that he carried, Lord, while he was here on this earth. Thank you for the lives he impacted, Lord, and thank you for his family. And I just want to pray this morning that you would bless this time in a special way, Lord. I pray that if there's anyone here this morning under the sound of my voice that has never come to know Jesus Christ, that today would be the day of their salvation. And, Lord, I think about what the Bible says, that we sorrow, but not as those that have no hope, Lord. And this morning, there's definitely sorrow, God. It's hard to lose a loved one, but God, what hope we have that if we know you, we will see him again one day. And I pray that There's someone here that doesn't have that hope this morning, that they would receive it before they leave. We love you. We just pray for your hand of blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Before I step away, I want to have Jennifer Torres come for the reading of the obituary at this time.
All right, bear with me. I'm trying to read it on my phone. All right, Norman Gerald Harwood, Grandpa, age 84. Passed away peacefully, surrounded by loved ones. On Saturday, January 1st, 2022. He was born on January 6th, 1937 in Lincoln, Nebraska. To George Harwood and Evelina Good. Norman married the love of his life. Vera Charlene White on June 17th, 1958 in Las Vegas, Nevada. Norman loved to travel with his wife and family as much as possible and going for rides anywhere just to go. His family has lots of fond memories of going for rides or trips together. He liked to go to Idaho to get lottery tickets. He loved spending time with his family and going out to eat together. He loved football. His favorite team was the Nebraska Cornhuskers. He liked to watch the games and cheer them on with his family. He loved his Western shows. John Wayne was his favorite. He also loved to watch Family Feud every day. Norman was a brother, dad, uncle, grandpa, and cousin to many, and created lots of great memories. His family remembers him playing basketball with all the kids and him breaking his leg twice trying to keep up with them. He used to have all of his girls play football with all of the boys, and they all had so much fun playing sports and spending time together. He would always sing songs to his kids and grandkids, and they can all remember the songs he would sing to them. His grandkids have so many memories of spending time with their grandpa, him taking them to get their scratchy tickets, heck yeah, going to the fair and riding the tilt-a-whirl, or as they would call it, the garbage cans. He loved to watch all the kids play their sports and was there to cheer them on at all of their games. He had a great sense of humor and liked to make jokes, mostly dirty, with everyone and make you laugh. It made him happy to see his family happy. He had a big family who all loved him dearly. And even though he is gone, we will always remember to be together because he lives on inside each of us in our hearts forever. Grandpa Norman served in the U.S. Army and served in the Korean War. He retired as a truck driver later in life. He took care of his wife, who suffered from a stroke for 17 years until her passing. He finally got to go to his happy hunting ground and be reunited with Grandma. Norman is survived by his children, Debbie and Monty Cummings, Leslie, Bub, Carrie Torres, George Cheryl Harwood, Jeannie and Tom Bush, Lena and Eric McTee, and Willie Harwood and Lori Woodbury. 14 grandkids, 26 great-grandkids, and 2 great-great-grandkids, and 2 sisters, Betty and Beverly. He is preceded in death by his parents, George and Evelina Harwood, and his wife, Charlene Harwood. 4 brothers, Dick, Bill, Jack, and Don, and 3 sisters, Thelma, Fern, and Ruby.
Thank you, everybody, for making it here today. I first would like to say, and this isn't just for my handsome grandpa. This is also for my beautiful grandma Charlene, as they are now joined together for eternity. I'm also here for my dad, who is also unable to make it today and is fighting to be here for his family. There are things I've always wanted to say, both to my grandma and grandpa, but sadly I was never given the chance I wanted, especially with grandma. With grandpa, it was to be honest, the man couldn't hear a jet if it flew over his head. So I never really had the patience to be able to tell him word by word. I never had the patience or one-on-one time to be able to tell them both how thankful I am from the bottom of my heart. Sometimes it surely takes something or somebody you love for some people to appreciate and realize the things we have been given. Thank you for the blessings you've given me. Thank you for the memories and all that all will last a lifetime. Thank you for the smiles, laughter, and all the lessons. And most of all, thank you for the people you've blessed me, blessed the world and this family with. Uncle Bob, Aunt Lena, Aunt Debbie, Uncle George, Aunt Jeannie, and most of all, my dad. You have taught each of them such love, kindness, strength, patience, support, and happiness because of you. All of us, which will continue to be honored and passed down to our families for generations to come. You have left a positive mark on this world and makes the world a better place in so many special different ways. Thank you for surrounding us with all of these blessings, and especially for the people that I am proud to call my family. You will always have a special place in our hearts that makes us who we are today and who we will become. I know you will always be here watching over us with love and protection, and will always follow our footsteps, and we will follow in your footsteps and make you guys proud. And for that, I just want to say thank you. I love you, Grandpa. Happy hunting. To heaven.
gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see the angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice.
I want to welcome you all here. For those who don't know me, I'm Carl Marino, or as all my cousins know me, as Skip. We all had nicknames in the Harwood family, all the boys. You know, I don't know that most of us even know each other's real names. I wanted to start off first talking about my Uncle Norman's Army service. I want to do that first because, you know, for me, being a little older than the rest of my cousins, all my other uncles were in World War II, and they talked about it, and you know, we always remembered the service that they did. My Uncle Norman, when Lena asked me to do this and we were talking, I'd completely forgot that he'd served in the Korean War and the service that he had given to our country. And I guess that's, you know, that was him. He just never talked about it. But that's kind of typical of veterans of the Korean War. They call it the Forgotten War for a reason. You know, it was the first war that the United States got in that they didn't win a victory. The war's technically still on. We're just in an armistice right now, in a truce. But He served. He served honorably, and he never talked about it. And I think, you know, if you can look back at him and you can pick any faults that you felt like he had, you might look at some of the PTSD that he may have carried through. War is hard on people, and not talking about it is harder. And he kept it to himself until, I guess, the last couple of years, you know, and I guess it finally reached the point where he had to talk about it. But I just felt that it was very important at this point that we at least recognize the service that he did and the sacrifices that he made. And ultimately, the thing to remember is that all the family of a service member also makes sacrifices because of that. And so that's a tribute to all of you as well. When I think of my Uncle Norman, I think of his three loves, of Charlene, family, and football. Anybody who ever saw Charlene and Norman, there's no doubt about the love they had. He always had a smile, and anytime he looked at her, it was a special smile. And when he talked about her, it was a special, it always meant the world to him to have her around. And family, I can remember conversations that he and I had about every one of you kids. He thought the world of all of them. And when I think of my Uncle Norman, I think of the smile. Whenever he would talk about his kids, he always had a smile. He was always thrilled to talk about them, and that was obviously his life. And that's who's going to miss him the most, obviously. Can I stop right here for all my cousins? Can I call a timeout? Because we don't want this to be sad. This needs to be uplifting. And for those of you who don't know why I'm calling a timeout, we're going to talk about football. Bub and I, Les and I, we coached Little League football for I don't know how many years. And the first year, there was nobody that could touch our team. We were the champions, and that was it. And Norman was there for every game. Norman and Charlene were our biggest fans. They never missed a game, even though none of their grandkids were playing. Bub was there, I was there, so they were there. So we went through the entire first year without a loss. We get to the second season, we go through to the second to last game, and we lose to a South Ogden team. And so we get to the last game, South Ogden's undefeated, we've got one loss, so we know we're not moving on. And we're down, we're playing a team, I can't even remember who it was, but they hadn't got a first down all day. We just controlled them, but our kids were down. They'd scored one touchdown. We were up 7-0. And we get to the last under minute of a game, and the other team has the ball, and we've got kids that naturally don't get to play as much as others, and I call the timeout. And Les goes, what? I won't use the words. He says, what are you doing? I said, let's get the kids in for the last couple plays. And this team that had not moved the ball all day throws a touchdown pass and ties the score. And we're now tied. And somebody comes and tells us that South Ogden just lost. And so now we would be in a tie with them, except they have the tiebreaker because they beat us. And I'm dying, and Les is going to kill me if I don't die on my own. And so we go into overtime, and the way they did overtime at that point is they put the ball on the 50, you flip a coin, one team gets the ball, they go as far as they can, and then the other team takes over and tries to get back over the 50. This other team moves the ball fairly well for a team that hadn't moved the ball all day. We get the ball. Les is the offensive coordinator. We go through the first three downs, and we're still way back. And I just know that, you know, he's looking at me. Everybody's looking at me as being the idiot that called the timeout. And I'll never forget, a kid named Brent Hadley comes around the corner. He's running right towards me, gets around the end, and runs for a touchdown. And we win the game, and we go on to the Mini Bowl. The only person who didn't criticize me for calling that timeout was Norman. And he knew that it was important to get kids playing. Of course, his first love was Nebraska football. And anybody who knew him knew how much he loved Nebraska football. He came by that love honestly. My mother, one of his older sisters, loved Nebraska football even when we came to Utah. We didn't miss a game that was on TV. And my Aunt Ruby, one of his other sisters, she came to Utah to visit relatives at one point, and it was in August. And she was planning on staying 2 weeks. She was here from Sunday till Thursday, and on Thursday she realized that she had misread the opening day for Nebraska football. And instead of staying for 2 weeks, she got on a plane and flew back to catch the opening game. Completely forgot about this day. And the most important thing was my mom completely understood. Everybody understood that Nebraska was more important. So he was dedicated to Nebraska football. And I can remember he definitely didn't tell Charlene, but he would tell my mom how much money he bet that Nebraska was always going to win. And it wasn't until the 70-71 seasons that he actually made his money back, and that's when they won the two national championships in a row. And I can just imagine with the way Norman bet on Nebraska, he was in heaven early. And I remember he went back to Nebraska and he brought my mom back. It was a ceramic football whiskey container, and it had Nebraska football as commemorative of the two national championships, and the stopper was the head of Bob Devaney, the head coach. And that was our prized possession. And when my mom passed away, that had to go back to my Uncle Norman. But he and Charlene made it to every Little League football game and were our biggest fans, always cheering us on. And they were so proud of Les for coaching, and then Willie came on and coached, and it was a family get-together every Saturday. It was great. For all of us cousins, we were just lucky to have the aunts and uncles that we had. When I think of Uncle Norman, I think of, it's always a smile. He was always smiling, always happy, and our uncles were horrendous at teasing us all. If our uncles were around, we were going to get picked on. And he would tease you, and he always had that smile, but it was a smirk. And he'd kind of picture up here, kind of looks like it. It was that smirk that he'd have. And he'd look over at Charlene, and she'd look at him like, leave the kids alone. We loved it. But you'd look at Charlene, and she'd look at you and just go, it's Norman. You know, he'd pick on you. That's what he did. You know, I think about it now, and all the uncles are gone. All but basically one of the aunts is gone. Two, the one really didn't get to grow up with the other ones, just the way things happen. But I got to say, it's got to be one hell of a party in heaven when they all got together. For those that remember the parties at my mom's house on Christmas, you couldn't see each other for all the smoke. But it was family, and that's what the Harwoods are, it's family. And I guess if there's anything that I can think that Uncle Norman would want to say to all of you is stay together. Be that, I know that they're all together up there, finally together, talking. I can only imagine what it was like when Norman and Charlene got to see each other. And then Norman with Uncle Don, Uncle Dick, Uncle Bill, Uncle Jack. They've just got to be happy as can be, and that's what we need to remember. And as a family, we need to make sure that all of us, we need to see each other more. Thanks.
to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart that something's missing. And they tell me that it's going to heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds can be erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven. On the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. But now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now. Even as the tears fall. That the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. Hallelujah, 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 for the hands that hold you now. There's not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run until I finally see what you can see. Such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. Thank
you. Thank you so much to all of you. I'm going to read out of Psalm chapter 23, but just before I do, I want to just have a short prayer. Let's pray. Father, we ask as we look into your word that you'll open our hearts and minds to it. God, we do understand that there's nothing dishonorable about dying. Especially someone that lived almost a full 85 years. But it still hurts. And God, we pray that Norman's death and the gathering of each of us together would accomplish something that would matter forever. God, we pray if there'd be even one soul under the sound of my voice without you as their Savior, we pray that today would be the day of their salvation. And Lord, together as we, those that know you, together pray, God, I pray we would, in unison and unity, ask you to touch Willie. God, I pray that you'd strengthen his lungs. And God, we thank you that the other body parts seem to be doing well. And this is unusual for someone suffering as he is with his lungs. And so, God, we know that you're the great physician, and you specialize in doing things that no one else can do. And that's why we're coming to you, ask you to touch him and heal him, strengthen him. God, please bring him back to his family and give him more years here on this earth if it be your will. And now we pray that you would touch us with your word. Draw us close. We ask you this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says in Psalm 23, it's a well-known chapter, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. And this morning I hope that we can do that, that we can find comfort in the Word of God and cast our care upon the Lord Jesus Christ. As all of this was happening, you know, the Lord gave me all kind of thoughts of what to say today, but as the service has gone on, I'm impressed to say what I'm going to say, and that is, what do you think gets a person to heaven? What do you think real righteousness is? You need to figure this out. Well, I just think, you know, some people shouldn't go because they're not very good. Okay, so you think some people should go because they are good? Yeah. Do you think God knows what he's talking about? Because he said there's none good. No, not one. And you don't, we don't get to compare ourselves among ourselves and decide who's saved and who isn't. And the moment a person received Christ as their Savior, they're dressed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Not because they brought themselves all cleaned up to the great physician, all well. I mean, how many of you ever call real frantic to the emergency room or call the ambulance? I need you to get here right away. I feel fine. What? Yeah, I'm fine. Everything's good. Hurry. No. Ambulances don't speed down the road, and policemen don't lead the way, and fire trucks don't come to your house because you called with a frantic, "I'm good." And yet religion comes along and says, no, that's what it's all about. Just clean yourself up. Do the 54 things we tell you to do, and you'll be fine. Yeah, you'll be good. Religious thoughts come along and say, well, I know stuff that other people here at the service don't know. Let them say what they want about my relative coming to Christ or knowing him, but I know he wasn't that good all the time in every area. But what you don't know is no one, not one person, has ever gone to heaven because they were good. No one. The Bible says David was a man after God's own heart. Yet if we were to list out all the things that we know David did, and we were to bring that to the religions of the world today and say, well, I don't want to spend a lot of time with you, but I can show you right here he was a murderer, and I can show you right here he was an adulterer. You know what the religions of the world would say today? He didn't make it. Yet God's word says he was a man after God's own heart. The world says, and religion says, if your good outweighs your bad, you go to heaven. But God says, no, there's none good, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous. And we all need a Savior. Well, what about keeping all the rules and keeping all the law and keeping all the things you're supposed to keep? Well, that's the thing is the Old Testament is the law, and the law was given to leave us all, get this, guilty. It wasn't given so that we could con ourselves into believing that we're better than someone else because we've done better at doing what's right, because that's what the law is, what's right. We've done better at doing what's right than most people, therefore God grades on a curve and I'm going to heaven. Well, guess what? I say this meaning, I mean it, but I don't mean it mean. You're not God. To get to heaven, you have to go through his standard, not yours. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. There is no man cometh unto the Father but by me. So there's only one way from earth to heaven, and that's through Jesus. The Bible tells us in Romans 4, what shall we say then that Abraham our father, as pertaining to the flesh, hath found? What did Abraham discover? What did God discover about Abraham? What's the truth about Abraham? For if Abraham were justified by works, he, Abraham, hath whereof to glory, but not before God. Do you realize if you could just be good enough to go to heaven, we wouldn't have needed a Savior? For what saith the Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it, that belief, was counted unto him for righteousness. When a man, woman, boy, girl, get this, 80-year-old, gets saved, they are instantaneously trading their unrighteousness for the righteousness of Jesus Christ. In that moment, they're washed in the blood of Jesus. Their sin is completely paid for. All sin, past, present, and future. And when the Father looks at them through the Son, through the sacrifice, the perfect death, burial, and resurrection, full payment for their sin, he sees them dressed literally in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. So if you could get saved by working really hard and doing your best, then you would earn it, and it wouldn't be grace. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Those who understand, I can't undo my sin. I need a Savior. Paul said this. God said it through him in Romans 10:1 about the most religious people on earth and God's chosen people. He says to those, the Jewish people, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. What? Why are you talking to us about that? A whole bunch of us memorize the first five books of the Bible. It's all we talk about day and nights, the Bible. It's all we talk about day and nights, the law. It's all we talk about all the time. I mean, we're so serious about what it says. We do extreme things. Yes, but they didn't know Jesus. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, how to be righteous before God, and going about to establish their own righteousness, how they decided to be righteous before God, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. The Bible says in Romans 11:6, and if by grace, if you're saved by grace, and if by grace, then it is no more works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. See, grace is when you get something you don't deserve. But if it be of works, then it is no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. And so, we come to these services and it's easy to say the things that the family wants you to say, but he's in heaven not because he lived a good life. I'm not saying he didn't, but that's not why he's in heaven. He's in heaven because he received Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior and trusted exclusively in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection for the full payment for his sin. And the moment that he did that, he traded the great exchange. He exchanged his unrighteousness for the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And all that went on in his life prior to that salvation is just clean and washed away. And the Father sees him as his own because he was purchased with the very blood of God, God the Son, Jesus. And you won't all go to be with him because it sounds pretty at a funeral. You won't all go to be with him because that's what you want to believe, that everybody that dies goes to heaven. You'll only go to be with him if you too walk away from believing that if you're good enough, you're going to make it. You're almost good enough now, just need a little Jesus tacked on. Nope. You need to come to him as a sinner. In debt and no way to pay. And trust Jesus Christ as the full payment for your sin. And then he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Anybody that recognizes that Jesus is God, Jesus loves me, Jesus died for me, Jesus was buried, rose again the third day according to the scriptures, has the power to forgive my sin, the desire to forgive my sin, that's who he's talking about when he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You want to go to see the Lord Jesus one day. And as awesome as it was that Norman was reunited with his wife, he got to go see Jesus. He got to go see Jesus. If he could come back and talk to you about it right now, first thing he wouldn't tell you is that he got to see his wife. It'd be that he got to see Jesus. And he got to see his wife. And he also got to see every other person who knew Christ and went on before him. And the craziest thing, David walked up to me and he knew me by name. And weirder than that, I knew him by name. Because he'll be in heaven, you're known even as you are known. It's, you know, even as you're known. There'll be no strangers in heaven. And you will be no stranger in heaven. But you don't go there because someone at a funeral said you do. You go there if you receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And I want to ask you to just take a moment here, because I promise you, I would stake my life on this, that if there's one thing, if he had 2 minutes with you, he would want you to hear the gospel and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. So you could go to be with Jesus and get to see him too. Your greatest priority would be getting to go see Jesus. So I'm going to ask you to just bow your head in the quietness of your own heart. Do you know him? Do you know Jesus? Or do you know about him? Well, I'm very religious. That's not my question. I know a lot of Bible. I can always do good at those quizzes and stuff. No, that's not my question. Do you know Jesus? Would you like to know him? He wants you to know him. He wants you to be born again. He wants you to be forgiven. And he said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you could call on him in faith and repentance, and you could pray something like this. Heavenly Father, I know I'm a sinner, and I know I don't deserve heaven. And I'm not bringing you anything worthy of heaven or forgiveness. I'm bringing you a guilty heart and a sincere heart that's asking you to forgive me of my sin and save my soul. I'm trusting in your perfect payment as my payment, your death, your burial, your resurrection as the full payment for my sin. And Father, I want to love you and serve you all the days of my life. I'm trusting exclusively in you now. In Jesus' name, amen. I hope many of you prayed and really trusted Christ as your Savior today, and that you would desire to walk in newness of life. You'd desire to learn and grow in the things of God. Because only Christ can save you. The law doesn't save you. Rules don't save you. Church doesn't save you. Only Jesus can save you.
We're going to sing one more song, In the Garden. Let's all stand.
Oh,
Right. Again, thank you so much for being here this morning. If we could at this time, want to have the pallbearers begin to make their way to the front. Also, our friends from the funeral home, make your way to the front too as well. I'm going to close in a word of prayer here. And if you would just do just like you're doing, get ready. As soon as I say amen, our funeral directors are going to turn the casket and we'll begin to make our way out. I just want to really encourage you. We have, they're going to be doing military honors at the graveside. So it's 20th on Monroe and Washington, Ogden Cemetery, for those that can come. But we need to, just as quick as we can, begin to make our way out. I believe they're going to be there around 12:15. It's cold outside. They'll be out there waiting for us to get there. So just as soon as you can make it out the door and head it towards the cemetery, that would be a great blessing. And thank you so much again for being here this morning. Let's go ahead and close on a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for the privilege of knowing Jesus Christ as Savior. Thank you for the comfort and the hope and the strength that you give. As a result of that, God, and I want to pray that your hand would rest upon this precious family, Lord, and friends, that you would carry them through this time, God, for your glory and honor. As we make our way to the cemetery, keep everyone safe, Lord, and I do pray that what takes place there would also bring you glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray.